interesting, because this is all about what you and I eat and how we don't need to put on weight. There's a guy behind me who actually says if you eat more, you can lose more weight. It's going to be a fascinating subject. And I'm very pleased to say that Victoria Shaw, one of our top commentators in Australia, has flown in on Emirates to greet what I think is an absolute star-studded panel. Enjoy the next hour and a quarter. Let's join Victoria Shaw.
Derek, thank you very, very much, and indeed to all of our audience here today on Yes Television as well. Welcome to our viewers. Yes, control, jockey diet, weight control and nutrition. It's a fairly hefty subject, but no doubt a very, very important one as well. Before we go any further, without further ado, it certainly is an honour and a privilege to be here amongst you all here today, and a sincere thank you to Her Highness Sheikha Fatima bint Mubarak and indeed His Highness Sheikh Mansour bin Zayed Al Nahyan and the wonderful Lara Sawaya for gathering everyone here today in the room. It certainly is an extraordinary opportunity and a wonderful energy to bring the world together in Arabian racing. Making weight for our jockeys is one of the most crucial aspects of race day, with the potential to ruin more than careers of our riders. Fluctuating weight and many methods of losing or keeping the weight off our riders and also down has a long-term and short-term health implications. For many of our key players, jockeys today look back at the past, the terrible past of cigarettes, laxatives, saunas and diuretics as a part of wasting, and all these dreadful applications that so many people engaged with in the past as race riders are now thankfully forgotten. But today we want to explore new methods and techniques combined with some common sense as well that will hopefully deliver new insight into an age-old problem for many of our jockeys and hopefully a point of difference as well. So without further ado, would you please welcome our panellists here this afternoon. Alongside me is Dr. Jamal Al-Hoot, a qualified paediatric. Jamal Al-Hoot's interest in complementary alternative medicines developed after the recovery of a patient with a severe milk allergy. Further studies into weight problems that looked at food intolerance issues also brings us another aspect to managing weight issues, given not everyone's immune system has the capacity to process some foods correctly, causing numerous health problems. Using the NAET, NATE, I'm going to attempt to pronounce this correctly, Nambudripad, is that correct?
Yeah.
I'm glad that's not a horse's name. Allergy elimination technique, a non-invasive treatment of which we will shortly find out more about and how this form of therapy can assist our riders here today and indeed around the world. Also joining us as well from the Elixir Clinic in London is Mahi Aramita and Akina Amoros as here today with a background in HIV and cancer research, as well as extensive studies of the impact of vitamins for the immune system and disease prevention. Mahi and Akina are part of recent developments that promote health and well-being with intravenous methods, combating fatigue, thyroid dysfunction, chronic fatigue syndrome, depression, and much, much more. Can this form of therapy assist some of our key players in the racing industry? And shortly we'll find out how. Also joining us here this afternoon is Xavier Ziani, riding for the El Asa stables here in the United Arab Emirates, originally from France, first licensed as a jockey in the UAE in 2006. Clearly, Xavier doesn't have an obvious weight issue. However, moving from Europe to the heat of the Middle East is not without its challenges. For many of you, a warmer climate can rob you of much-needed energy, including Xavier. So discussing how we can better manage energy levels is a very important part of a jockey's health regime. Now, Xavier also has a ride this Sunday, which we'll talk about towards the end of the session as well, but welcome to Xavier. Also on the panel today, an esteemed jockey indeed, Chantel Sutherland. Welcome to you, Chantel. One of the world's most famous professional female jockeys who created history here in the United Arab Emirates back in 2012, being the first woman to ride in the Dubai World Cup. And I think that deserves a round of applause as well, Chantel. Certainly an extraordinary achievement, and I really believe part of the overall drive of this festival, putting people into places they previously haven't been here before. And a big thank you everyone in the Emirates as well, welcoming Chantel back in 2012 to ride in that incredible race. From many stellar racing career highlights, including a Hollywood Gold Cup as well, and nearly 1,000 racing victories, Chantel brings great insight to our panel here this afternoon, having worked firsthand in other guises as well that are heavily affected by weight, including television and modelling. Combined with Chantel's scholastic achievements, a degree in communications and psychology as well, Chantelle's experience in racing and working life in general will no doubt be able to impart practical knowledge to our audience here today and, very importantly, our young riders. On the end, no stranger to the Sheikh Mansour Festival, Dr. George Wilson of Liverpool's John Moores University from the Sport and Exercise Sciences Faculty of Science, a former jockey himself, sports psychologist, personal trainer, musician and doctor, and has had many publications released throughout the world. And we'll go into his studies later on in about health and, of course, the important part that diet plays in a jockey's overall racing life and beyond that as well. So please welcome our panellists here this afternoon. Now, Xavier and Chantelle, if I can throw it to you firstly in the centre of our panel here, both of you with first-hand experience as jockeys, what has been the most difficult or challenging moments in your career that was weight-related? Chantelle, can we start with you firstly? What do you think in your long-standing career do you believe has been one of the most challenging moments due to a weight issue, whether you felt you were tired, your energy levels were down, or perhaps when you wanted to quicken on a horse and you just didn't have the energy to go with the horse at that point in time? Was there any moment that stands out to you in your career that you believe perhaps your diet and your behaviour let yourself down?
I think a big part of when apprentices learn at a young age, I was not that young, so I was 20 when I started my apprenticeship, and the weights are so light compared to what they are now for when you lose your bug. And I found that I got some bad habits with some of the jockeys. You just learn bad habits with your eating. And then to change my body to eat healthy, and that was kind of a struggle. And to learn that, you know, some of the bad habits that you learn can really mess up your thyroid, your metabolism, and it mentally plays with your mind. And the dehydration factor in racing is really not good for any athlete, because you're 30% less productivity when you're even a little bit dehydrated. So getting to get healthy after being an apprentice was, you know, it took a lot of work and a lot of determination, because it's very easy to be not disciplined and to eat whatever you want, and then to teach yourself that you need to be disciplined and to work hard to be healthy and also just be hydrated. Not only helped my performance, but it was definitely a struggle to make that transition.
And how long in your career, so you in your early 20s, when that sort of first behavior you noticed that you needed to adapt or change your ways, did you find yourself sort of slipping in your behaviors at all, or did you find yourself sort of moving forward and not going back to behavior that you wish that you had continued on with, and you know, your newfound, your insight into what you needed to do to maintain good health to deliver a good outcome on the racetrack?
To maintain good health, it takes a lot of exercise. So each person has a different body, and I can develop muscle easily, so and which is heavier than fat. And I decided that what worked for me was yoga, hot yoga, and a lot of cardio. I used to do a lot of weight training with some of the other guys, like Mike Smith, and but that works for them, but I was just getting too thick with that. And so that, in combination with eating healthy and just continually, you know, really every day you have to focus on your, you have to make sure that you're on like a schedule, and you can't, you know, when we travel and stuff, we kind of let ourselves go a little bit, but it is important that you know what you're eating, and just really being mindful of what you're putting into your body. And then, I guess, does that answer your question? I think.
Sure. Now, Xavier, your situation, I wouldn't exactly say that you really do have a weight issue, but maintaining energy levels is very important for you too, particularly riding in a country such as the UAE or the surrounding region. Heat obviously takes its toll. Perspiration, you're using a lot of body salts. What do you do to try and maintain your energy levels during race day?
Well, as we talked earlier, weight problem, but in UAE the main problem is dehydration. So you always have to, whenever you exercise, you always have to drink water after, even if you are heavy or you want to lose weight, because this water, it's really helpful for the body, for the brain as well. So, and especially in the Middle East, we are racing with a high temperature outside, so you really have to be careful on what you are doing. I'm very lucky, I don't have a weight problems, but as Chantal says earlier, you have to find exercise good for your body. As she says, she was doing fitness with Mike Smith, but it was not working for her because she was going to have a muscle which is heavier than fat. So she changed to yoga. So maybe if I was doing the same, it won't work for me. Everyone is different. Again, I'm very lucky because I'm having light bones, so I can exercise myself and it's fine. I can go running, I can go cycling, it'll be fine for me. But for some jockeys, because of them height, of them weight, the bones weight, they struggle, so they have to find different way. So today we are on the panel to talk about that, and now new technology, new medicines coming on the market. So the doctors will explain to us, and I tried myself what this gentle lady is doing, and it's really helpful. They will talk better than me on that later.
Sure. Now, Xavier, your natural light weight, about 52, 53 kilos. George, to you on the end with your extensive research into jockeys' diets and how that affects jockeys' performances, as Chantal mentioned first up as well, the wrong style of exercise gave her an outcome that she wasn't exactly after.
Yeah, it's very difficult to put muscle mass on, particularly a female. I mean, people say muscle's heavier than fat. Yeah, it is, because the density of it is heavier. But a pound of fat and a pound of muscle weigh the same. It's just the density. So you get the perception that muscle's heavier than fat. But it's very, very difficult to put muscle mass on. And one good thing about actually increasing muscle mass is it speeds up your metabolism, because muscle's metabolic. You know, it improves your calorie output. So I wouldn't be too akin to sort of warning young jockeys, the apprentices out there, to stop doing weight training. Do weight training. Look at Mo Farah. Mo Farah is a world-class 10,000 metre marathon runner. He's like that. At the end, he does lots of weight training. So it is the type of training to put muscle mass on. You have to get your diet completely right, and you have to do the absolute, really high intensity, real heavy, heavy weights. Do light weights till you fatigue, which you do every day riding the horse. Isn't problematic. In fact, it will increase your deltoid strength, and that's what you want. So again, I take the point that you have to watch muscle mass, but don't be scared of doing weights, because with the right training and the right expertise, there's not a problem with doing weight training.
George, thank you. Now, Dr. Jamal, your line of work, with a paediatrics background and a qualified medical practitioner, you've also explored elements of kinesiology and a more holistic approach or angle on this subject. What would you advise people when they're looking at weight issues? And obviously, weight is reflective of their performance and at the end of the day, their income as well, you know, their working capacity. How would you advise people to perhaps take a different angle or a different approach given your background?
We know that when you eat something wrong, your energy balance is disrupted. And that's what makes you lose your energy. And at the end of the day, you are weak and debilitated. So just looking into the food intolerance panel and we find what's proper for you, it gives you the right energy and it gives you, you will avoid the addition of fats. Of course, we need proper physical exercise from time to time, but you cannot spend all your time in doing exercise. So it's better to eat what's right for you, and this will give you the proper energy at the end.
Certainly. Now, Xavier and Chantal, both different body styles. You know, it's a very grueling, demanding sport. Xavier, you mentioned earlier on when we first started here as well that you've started to explore new techniques as well in terms of managing your health. And as we look at Akinia Mahi this afternoon, who is sort of new additions to the Sheikh Mansour Festival, with the point of difference that they represent about intravenous therapies. Mahi, do you want to touch a little bit on about what your line of work and what you're presenting here today and how that can impact in a positive way on our athletes?
Absolutely. So the Elixir Clinic, basically, we opened approximately 4 years ago. The clinic is focused on holistic health, alternative medicine. As Victoria said earlier, we did We had an extensive research on with cancer patients and HIV patients. Both these categories had immune problems after lots of therapies and automatically lots of issues with their diet. The human body, depending on what we need and what we are eating and according to what the doctor said, if you don't eat correctly, then your whole diet and your whole energy balance will be disturbed. So what we do at Elixir, we focus on only vitamins, minerals, amino acids. We deliver all the nutrients intravenously. So this is a new concept that we brought into the UAE region across to UK as well. We're one of the first clinics that they opened in London. But it's been along all these years, almost 30 years now around the world. What we do specifically, we deliver IV vitamins, which is IV infusion, as you all know, intravenously. And all our formulas, we mix and blend vitamins and minerals according to what your body needs. We deliver the right nutrients according to your blood test, your bloodstream, and we make sure that people who train a lot or people who travel a lot or people who are they don't have the time or they don't have the right knowledge of what to eat or how to train, we make them feel much better, and that's with very simple vitamins and minerals. I kind of can explain more about all our vitamins and minerals and what exactly we deliver.
Thank you. Now, Akinyi, your work as well in the clinic, you've both got a nursing background. Tell us a little bit about your studies that led us to this path here and opening the Elixir Clinic. How's your mic going?
No?
Yes.
So Mahi and I used to work together in London. Yes, no?
That's good.
Mahi and I used to work together in London as nurses. As Mahi said before, we used to work with HIV patients and cancer patients. We could see the difference on working day by after day with these cancer patients, how they were improving their health. They were feeling much better, much more energized. Their immunity system was improving. And obviously hydration. And these patients don't have a proper diet, and they've been through big treatments and big traumatism for the body. So you could see the difference between not feeling that well and just with vitamins and minerals. It's just an alternative medicine to feel much better. We used to treat only people with depression, cancer patients, chronic fatigue, more ill patients, and we saw the need of giving this type of treatments to people that actually are not ill, they are healthy, and they want to improve, they want to become better with their health. In London, as Mahi said, we were the first clinic to open this type of treatments, and that's why people they got very interested on trying the treatment and to actually basically the to become more of mainstream, because in the States, as Mahi said, the treatment was for the last 30, it's been on the market for the last 30 years, but in the UK only for 4 years. Here in the UAE we came last year. We've been educating people, introducing the treatment, and that's how we are now.
Now, I've seen this style of therapy being offered in Australia, where I come from, only in the last sort of 2 to 3 years. Xavier, you alluded to earlier on that you've engaged these services, and you touched on the point earlier that hydration was your biggest issue. So how have you found this style of therapy assisting you with your racing career?
Sorry, can you say again?
How have you found that this style of therapy has assisted yourself?
Yeah, of course, yeah. Again, because what I didn't mention, here your body is doing as well water retention.
Yep.
So it's also hard to lose weight. You can then exercise, you can do whatever, but the body is a machine. So and the body knows better than anyone what he needs. So even if I was exercising or drinking just a bit after, my body was keeping all the water and I was not losing any weight. So again, it's about an education, as you mentioned as well in Rome when we were on this panel. It's the way to educate your body to teach us to eat the good things, to have a good health. That's why this new technology are really important for us, I believe. I tested myself and I really felt the difference, because even if I'm not having a weight problem as a jockey, it's not mean I'm eating properly and I'm feeding my body properly. I'm giving the energy to my body. So that's another, it's something different than what we are talking about, but I believe in school we should teach the jockeys the way to feed themselves, to improve, to be stronger in the race, to have more energy at the finishing.
Exactly. Now, George, your extensive work in the university and the studies that you've engaged with over you know, a great period of time, do you find by and large young people that you're seeing or looking at statistically, do you think that they come from backgrounds where they've got not a clue about what their dietary intake is, or do you find that people are being more educated these days?
Yeah, we get a real mixed bag, the apprentices coming through. On a positive note, we, since being funded by Shape Mansfield Festival, and thanks again, Lara, we've had a deluge of people, because now the message is out there. You go to Liverpool, John Moores University or in England to get to look after your weight. But we have had a deluge of apprentices, and we're a real mixed bag. To answer your question, Victoria, they come from all backgrounds. And some of these young apprentices, these young kids, may have had a bit of a physical education background, so they may know a little bit about basic nutrition. Others will have no idea. Others come from other sports, which is good. So we're dealing with a real sort of basic level. We start at a very basic level, trying to educate them. And the key to this, really, is to keep the message simple, because we're not trying to get these apprentice jockeys to have a PhD, you know. We're just trying to get them so they understand the best nutrition and the best way of fueling themselves and how that will impact upon their performance. So, can everyone hear me all right, yeah? Sorry, I shout a bit louder. And I'm being attacked by that fly as well. Is that fly been getting you? Me and Ada? We're not waving after each other, people. We're getting attacked by a fly.
Sweet person, that's why.
Is he getting you as well? Mm. Anyway, we'll go back to the fly in a minute. But to answer your question, we some of the kids have an idea, but the idea with from the racing schools is that by the time, the time they leave, they do have the sort of tools to go away and implement the best dietary practices. And from our research and my research, we have sort of changed the advice given now by the racing schools. Indeed, when I do the presentation later, we actually know that the Australian apprentice schools are taking on board some of the recommendations from John Moores University in England, so the message is getting there, you know.
Now, certainly, as Xavier mentioned too, in this country, water retention is an issue. George, your work in the UK, if you look at the issues that jockeys are encountering there, by and large, by Australian standards and Middle Eastern standards, it's cold. So there's different issues for different parts of the world. Do you want to take us through your presentation now?
Yeah, no problem.
If you don't mind.
Okay.
Now, the sample of people amongst this presentation that the jockeys that you've studied are from whereabouts, Stuart?
Mostly the UK, but we have had some international jockeys. We've had jockeys from France, some jockeys from Canada. So the word is getting out there, you know. Right, where are we? Slideshow. So, folks, I'm just going to do a small presentation, and hopefully you'll find it interesting. Some of the work you will see. There's me. As you can see, and the guy next to me is, anyone recognise him? It's the champion, it's the king, isn't it? T.P. McCoy, who was mad enough to let me take blood from him, which was very good of him. But the key I put this slide up, the key message is that if A.P. McCoy can change after 25, 30 years of riding, trying to learn about other things, I mean, he's been 20 times champion jockey, and that was only recently. So if he can change, we can all change. And I always have this saying, beware the expert. Because every expert I've ever met is, I don't want to swear, but it's an absolute... We all learn, and Richie Mullen said something earlier today, dead important. We're all learning all the time. So if AP can change, we can all learn, yeah? I think we'd all agree with that. So, take you back a little bit about me. I had to dig this out. I actually went to my mum's house, and that's in 1989 now. And I found one of my first pictures arrived, and I was about 10 stone there, 64 kilo. So I have been there, and I do look a bit of a, well, you know, I think I'd get a job as a scarecrow after that job. So anyway, probably make more money as a scarecrow. Right, so importantly for what was being said on the panel is that when we looked at the jockeys, we actually found there was room for improvements, as we said before, and I'm just doing a quick recap here. We found average percentage body fats, 14 to 16%. No athlete in the world worth the salt or hair salt will, well, a female will have more, but especially a male jockey would not have 14, 16% body fats. So there was room for improvement. So straight away we could take the body fat down. So that's really important. And how did we do it? We used a lot of science. There's some DEXA scans. And again, there's a guy called Slade O'Hara, who was a flat jockey. Don't know what Slade's up to at the moment, but he was working with us. And he's quite lean, and that was after 6 weeks of working with us. He's starting to look like an athlete now. As you can see, he's quite lean. We never give him the tattoo, by the way. Okay. Now, what we did find with the jockeys as well was that their rest and metabolic rate had been compromised. If you don't feed yourself and starve yourself, and you fast intermittently, the body expects fuel. Do what nature intended. Give yourself fuel and food. If you don't, your body can't survive on nothing. So it will crash its metabolic rate. The metabolic rate wasn't so much crashed, it was just low. So much so that when we compared the male jockeys to the female jockeys, which is unheard of, the males had the same or even lower metabolic rate than females. I go back to my earlier point, muscle speeds up metabolism. Males have more muscle than females. If you've got more muscle mass, you'll have a higher metabolic rate. In some of these jockeys, they never. Why? Because they've been starving themselves. And you can't do that, as you can see. So it was cultural. So we changed it. We started saying, we can give you the correct nutrition. We'll give you higher levels of protein. We'll give you lower levels of carbohydrates. We'll give you healthy fats. We'll feed you six times a day. We'll get some fasted exercising. That is running first thing in the morning. And watch what happens. Your weight will drop. And it did. Right? So we understood the physiology. So the take-home message was, starving and chronic dehydration to make weight are not essential. They are cultural. Everyone agree? It's what you're told, yeah. It's cultural. It is cultural. 150 years ago, we used to put children up chimneys to clean them. We don't do it anymore. It was cultural. People thought it was okay. Slavery, it was good, yeah. No, it wasn't good. It's bad. And, you know, it's a bad analogy, but you get the point what I'm trying to say. So, they're not essential. So that brings us up to our recent research, Lara, for the last year, what we've been doing. Now, this is really important for all the jockeys. We actually done the first studies to use to absolutely nail it how much energy a jockey burns. Because what we've been told by the previous literature was that these jockeys, they burn up lots of energy and they need lots of fuel. Well, when we looked at the research, they actually don't burn up that much energy in race riding. If you think about a flat race, a flat horse race, the race is won from about 2-3 furlongs out. Most of the time, unless a horse is pulling really hard, and there's an isometric force contraction, which is, there's energy for that, you only start throwing a kitchen sink at it 3 furlongs out. And as Pat will tell you and all the jump jockeys, over jumps, most of the field will be there till 3-4 fences from home. Most of the field are there because nothing's really going on. Just trying to get around and survive. So what we found was, isn't that right, Pat? Right. What we looked at, this looks very scientific, and it is. It's quite good science. We give the jockeys this doubly labelled water, which is a chemical isotope, a stabilised isotope, which settles in the water pool of the body. And then what we do is we measure the energy expenditure for race riding, for mucking out, for working throughout the day, and we see how many calories a day a jockey who works in racing throughout the day would burn. What we found was, actually, it wasn't that high. We actually see the total was only around about 2,800 calories and an average, and that was even for jockeys who were riding at 6, 7, 8 races a day. So some of the jockeys were higher, hence the big blue one at the top.
and that was at a British jockey, and I'll explain why this was a lot higher, but generally, they never burn that much energy. So if you're trying to feed a jockey like a soccer player, or a basketball player, or a runner, they're going to put weight on. And the reason jockeys didn't take any notice of nutritionists before, blow our own trumpet, we intervened, is because if they followed the nutritional guidelines, they'd all be 15 stone, because they weren't burning up enough energy. Why are people put weight on? Because their energy intake is greater than their energy output. Simple equation, very simple maths. I won't go on. Now, the interesting thing, this is really interesting, this slide. We wanted to see where the energy was being burned. Well, it wasn't in race driving, because it's nowhere near that straight line. So the correlation between how much energy you put out and how much is in race driving is not a good correlation. If you look at race rides and riding out, still it's not a good correlation. You want to be near that white line. It starts getting better now when we look at those jockeys who exercise. They're getting closer. But where was it all done? It was a combination of both. So that gives us the message to tell all you jockeys out there, you have to exercise. If you want to make weight safely without starving and sweating, you need to get out and train. And the good thing about that is, that's exactly what you're genetically coded to do. The human body expects to get up and get you out running. So I'll just take you through, and here's the message. Contrary to popular belief, the major contributor to a jockey's daily energy demands is not race riding, it's structured additional exercise. You get out running in the morning, and your weight will come down. Okay? Now, there's me and Franny Norton, little Franny, who comes all the time, taking him through a bit of boxing. You've got to eat, but you've also got to do exercise. Now, just quickly through the education where we're at the moment, if I'm okay, Victoria, you have to kick on. What we now, we're putting this all into practice. We know the cutting strategies, or common strategies, dehydration, starving, sweating. Unfortunately, some jockeys do actually make themselves sick, which is, if Tony Smith is here from the Racing Post, there's been some nice stuff in the Racing Post highlighting this. So what we wanted to do is change those strategies. And there you can see them all again, laxative, sweatsuits, vomiting, flipping, whatever you want to call it. It's not good. How does it impact upon a jockey's health for all you young jockeys and even older jockeys? It's a physiological health, which I'll talk about in a minute, but also psychologically. The more I study this sport and work with athletes, honestly, folks, it's all in the head, because you can tell people anything, but if they don't believe you, you're wasting your time. So the psychology is absolute. And obviously there's some disruptive hormone and immune function. The immune system was down. Okay? Early indications of what we've done. Yeah, we've certainly improved in all those areas. There's less reliance on bad practices. More jockeys want to know about how to make weight properly. That includes the senior jockeys, hence AP McCoy come to see us. And we're certainly seeing improved performance, but also improved psychological health, which is absolutely imperative. And you can see some happy jockeys there. You might recognise a few of the guys. Danny Sudhoop and Phil Macon and Russ Kennemore. There's Franny and Paul Mulrennan. And the poor guy running is PJ MacDonald. And they're all laughing his head off while he's going up the hill with me. And just to show you how simple we kept this. First thing I ever do when I talk to the kids and the jockeys is, if you're having a breakfast of 4 biscuits and a cup of tea, it adds to about 334 calories, right? And it's all fast sugar. For the same thing, you could have a 3-egg omelet, right? I mean, you know, even looking at that, you know which one you go for. If anyone says the biscuits, I'm leaving. But 200 kilocalories, less calories on a big omelet, you know? So I keep it simple, and I'll fly through these because I don't want to bore you. Basically, keep the message simple. Show people bad choices, good choices. Don't have cornflakes for breakfast. I hope nobody works for cornflakes through the year, no? Don't have cornflakes for breakfast. Go for something which is a slower release carbohydrates. Okay? Save for your lunch. These things in green are good for you, and we'll talk about this at the workshop. If you want to make weight, don't go near the bad choices. Although now and again, you do need them. And dinner choices, same again. You know, education, that's what it's all about. And we are getting there. Winding up now, we've actually now have 8 principles of nutrition for the PGA, and I mentioned Australia, which I'll flick up, somewhere there, has actually embraced our strategy for weight making now. So now we're looking at being smart, you know, eating 5 times, 6 times a day, and following those principles. So we are winning the battle. It's a long way to go, but we are winning the battle. And just to wind it up, I've got a lovely picture that I want you to leave with. The guy on my right, on your left, is Robbie Davis Jr. He's a world champion boxer. He met Jim Crowley at our university. Jim Crowley's currently the flat champion Great Britain. They got on really well. And I introduced Jim to Robbie. I said, this is Robbie Davis Jr. He's world intercontinental lightweight champion. And Jim went, that's great. About 2 weeks after that, I spoke to Jim again, and he said to me, I think I can win the jockey's title. True story. I said, really, Jim? He said, yeah, I'm going freelance. I think I can win it with your help. I'm following your nutrition. I'm doing all the things you've said. And I met that guy, Davis Jr. Totally, unbelievably inspired me. George, I really think I can win it. I said, we will work with you, Jim. And what a great story. Jim won it. Anyway, thanks for your time. Cheers. There you go.
Dr. George, thank you very, very much.
Do you want me to switch it off?
Just going to switch off the microphone.
Yeah, there you go. All right,
there you go. But George, as you work your way back to your seat, one point up there, which I think a lot of people that have race ridden or going through their apprenticeship at the moment, or indeed our senior riders as well, mental health issues are a big part of, or an outcome due to, whether we've been wasting, abusing our diets, or eating properly. And of course, the nervous energy surrounding a race, the pressure involved, the anxiety, pride, an apprentice having their first event, of course, on the track, and other issues such as sleeplessness. What have you discovered with the sort of the mental health aspects, the further you've got into your research? Do you see things improving, or is that an area that needs further exploration?
Well, we've certainly seen mood improve. Now, your mood state is only a snapshot of how you feel. So if I asked everybody in this room about their mood, how they feel, we'd have different answers, because, you know, we can't be happy all the time. But what we did find was we did see a lot of impaired mood, so very, very negative mood states, totally very abnormal mood states compared to other athletes. You'd expect being an athlete, you'd be happy and have a lot of vigor and energy. We didn't really see that, and that is in over maybe 200-300 jockeys that we tested. Generally, the sort of relationship between mood and being a jockey was a negative one. But what we have seen, Victoria, is a complete flip of that now. Most people who work for us, and by definition, the ones who stay with us, are the happy ones, and they stick with us. And our dropout rate is very, very, very low. But on a further mental side, I'm not qualified because I'm not a psychologist, but our clinical psychologist did see some issues. And we do know if somebody's prepared to put the fingers down the throat to make themselves make weight, I would argue you've got some serious issues with yourself.
Yeah, exactly. And I too have seen those articles published by the Racing Post about flipping and, you know, just obviously the long-term harm, not just psychological, but obviously the esophagus and many other organs in the body, your teeth, of course, and we could go on and on about that. But the psychological aspects of not eating correctly or wasting, trying to make weight, are absolutely extraordinary. I had a situation at home in Australia. I quite often call races in the bush, and it was an exceptionally hot day, just over a year ago, about 40 degrees Celsius. A man who was struggling to make weight, and it was at the end of his career, he's probably not that much shorter than myself, probably about George's height. And as we went down to the gates, I focused on him as he's being loaded into the stalls, and one of the starters handed him a bottle of water. He was sweating profusely, given the heat, and he swished it around in his mouth, and then he spat it out. Of course, he wasn't going to swallow the water because his weight would have been affected. I found out at the end of the event he hadn't eaten in 3 days. And what transpired, I think that fly is trying to become roughage. What transpired from this race event, unfortunately, was that he shot to the lead, he was determined to win, and that fly's gone for good now, and he was determined to lead, he got out to the front, and coming into the home straight, he looked like the race was his, and the pack behind him was probably about three or four lengths away, and this woman all of a sudden broke free aboard her mat, caught out wide, came down the outside, and on the line, she was all hands and heels, and this gentleman is actually riding with a whip rather vigorously. This woman had this horse hands and heels, punched her mount out, on the line, pipped him by about a nose. He hadn't eaten in 3 days. He's a rather argumentative Australian type. Believe me, there's a few. And he was less than impressed when they returned to weigh in. And as he's gone back to the male change rooms, he's done a complete 360, spun around, and ran into the ladies' change rooms to abuse her. She beat him fair and square. There was no tactics throughout this event that were inappropriate, and he just couldn't handle it. And clearly he was a man who wasn't drinking correctly. He was spitting the water out before he actually started the race. He hadn't eaten in 3 days. He was roughly about 5'9", almost 5'10", so he's struggling with his weight. And his behaviour was just insane. It was monstrous. The language out of him, the abuse. The stewards were just dumbfounded. They didn't know what to do. These types of behaviours, we're seeing just complete irrationality out of people in extreme situations. And sadly, this event wasn't worth a lot of money, so he wasn't making a lot out of it. But I think the message that we take from everyone up here today is that your diet is more than just your immediate physical presence, your weight. It's what drives you and what keeps you going, and ultimately what helps you keep your job too. So that's very, very important. Dr. Jamal, your work and research into behaviour and the more holistic side, George has spelled out loud and clearly there about a balanced diet.
Definitely.
Tell us a little bit about your work. And we spoke too about you can't keep a person basically like a caged animal with this very strict diet. You will only do this, you will only eat that. How do you basically stop them from going crazy?
That's why when we do the allergy test for the food intolerances that the patient has, he will know what to eat, and this will keep him going on the right way. He will be supplied with his necessary vitamins, minerals, and of course he will not have much water retention that usually when you eat wrong you will have them. And this will keep him physically and mentally right. And this is what we aim at the end. We need a full, healthy person with us, mentally and physically.
Exactly. Now, as the point earlier that I think is really important that Xavier made about fluid retention, you know, so many people manage to keep their weight down or work hard, or as Chantal discovered, the right application of exercise for her that finally struck that balance. Your work with kinesiology and muscle testing, how do we know that the kidneys are functioning correctly, given the extreme situations a lot of our riders are placing themselves in?
Usually with kinesiology, it's just a science to balance the energy. And just testing the person at different stages, we have different areas to test. We test all the organ systems that are working or not working right. And we know where's the blockage of energy is. And that's why we try to handle it right away at the site where the blockage is, whether it's kidneys, liver, lungs, wherever it is. And this is where we tackle the problem where it is, and we can try to handle it and take the toxin out.
So in finding someone's correct energy balance, I mean, at the end of the day, too, a horse and rider is a combination. You're not out there as an individual. You're aboard that animal, that horse. Effectively, you are one. You are a combination. And a horse will sense our energy levels, as our speakers earlier on and Julie Crone earlier mentioned on about a horse being receptive to our energy levels. How does a jockey strike that balance? What do you believe that they should do to sort of keep themselves physically effective so they can get the most out of themselves on race day?
When he is at ease, it means he has his full energy, he's relaxed, he's mentally well. He can handle the horse easily, and the horse will feel it. And that's how, when he's ready, he ate what he should eat. At the end, he's well balanced, and this is what will let the horse feel the good thing about this jockey or whatever.
Sure. And from George's studies about eating correctly, of course, when you eat correctly, and as Dr. Mal points out, you are balanced as well.
Yeah.
Your energy levels, you will deal with stress in a better capacity.
Definitely. So at the end, it's awareness and education, which takes a lot of effort to do, but this is what we need. And of course, there should be the will of the person to handle himself right, and there should be a good guidance to follow him up, and he should persevere to reach the end and be a healthy human being.
Now, Mahi and Akinya, here in the centre, your work and your research too, when we go back to fluid retention, are our internal organs working correctly to deal with different situations? And of course, heat here in the Middle East is different, so the body does behave a little bit differently. Its natural, you know, immediate reaction is to retain the water so you don't lose it. How do you see that, or your work and studies, how do you see trying to combat this situation for riders so they can get the most out of themselves and maintain their weight to an optimum outcome on race day?
It's very, very important to drink the right amount of water. Now, people, most of the time, especially athletes, it doesn't mean that if you drink constantly a liter and a half of water in one go, you will be hydrated. As the doctor said very correctly, it's very, very important to have the right nutrition. But also, people need to know that every single person, and we always say that to our clients, they're completely different. Every single person is individual. So you should all sit down and see what is really good for you, what you love eating, because it's not only about what you should eat, it's the quality and what you should actually enjoy eating. Because this, at the end of the day, is going to affect your mood. But you need to make sure you are hydrated. You need to make sure you're fully hydrated. From our experience, we've experienced, yes, more from the more medical side rather than on a daily basis, that people can get very easily dehydrated and can get very easily dehydrated. Why? Because they just simply forget to drink water. You can get hydrated in many different ways. The best way to get hydrated is to have the right amount of water at the right time, before and after exercise, during exercise, or whenever you feel that your body is thirsty. Your body gives you all the signals, and I really, really believe in that. Signals that can affect your mood, signals that can affect your performance, signals that you should just not simply avoid. Nutrition, super important, by taking very, very simple vitamins through your diet or even supplementation, for example, B12 or some vitamin D, it will affect your mood very well. B12 will give you the right amount of energy so you could actually push yourself, and you should be very careful on what you're taking. Now, water, of course, and as I said, you need, every single body is different, so you can do a research on yourself, you can do a blood test, you can do, there are different type of blood tests that you can actually achieve, and you can see what actually your body needs. What I always say to my clients and my patients is that you should never go to nutritionists and expect them to tell you, you should eat this, you should eat that, and you're not one. You're not like everyone else. Your body is different according to your body type, according to your height, according to your weight, is different from the person next to you. So what you should really do is to look into yourself individually. Yes, you might be training on 5 to 8 races a day, you might be training 2-3 days races a day. You should make sure you stay hydrated, and especially in this region. In London, as Victoria said, it's different. It's different because people do remember to drink water. We don't get that dehydrated. There are different aspects in our life that we have to consider. For example, the weather there is colder, here is much warm. During summer months, if you want to carry on training, then you need to be super careful, and your water income, you should just make sure you have the right amount. Lots of athletes all over the years, and that's where we're coming from as well, is they did realize that drinking water was not enough for them, because they used to do the mistake of drinking a liter and a half in one go. They would discard it within the next hour. And we had lots of athletes, and we worked with lots of people on the well-being side, that they would come to us after an exercise, after a training, and we would just give them a very small amount, like 15 milliliters of intravenously fluids. That made a huge difference in their mood. It made a huge difference in their energy levels, and they could recover much easily. You want your muscles to recover faster. You train. You train why? You train because you want to perform better. You push yourself to the edges. You always make sure you want to be the best. And there are times that you forget that your body, even that it gives you signals, cannot cope. How you can manage that? Very simply, make your own schedule. Make your own training schedule, and according to that schedule, always, always fit in between times that you need to eat and what you should eat, and drink lots of water. If you reach a stage in your later career that you really need a boost, let's say, or you will need, or you're exercising a lot, or you've been in a huge race and you feel exhausted, or it's been a period that psychologically, maybe from personal or work issues, you're not 100% yourself, then it's not a bad idea to seek an additional advice or maybe get a boost in a more clinical environment, and that's where we come.
Mahi, thank you. Now, Chantelle, take us back to World Cup night in Dubai. Coming from the United States, as Xavier's been here in the UAE for some time and adjusted to the weather, coming from the US of A, how much time had you spent in the Middle East previously, or was the weather a bit of a shock for yourself? How did you acclimatise, and indeed physically, the pressures of being here in a warmer climate, and also the nervousness and the anxiety of such an event? How did you find yourself coping? Did you have to do anything different in terms of what you're eating or drinking to get yourself through such a monumental occasion?
For me, I've always felt like if I train in the heat, then I can adapt to it better. So I did go running when I got here in Dubai, and it was really hot. And I drink a lot of water, and the more water I drink, I've learned with my body, the more I sweat and the more weight I lose. And that helps with my yoga as well, because I do hot yoga. But that night it was really hot, and I remember Rafael Bejarano, he rode before me, and he said, you know, whatever you do, don't warm up the horse, because Game On Dude was getting really hot, and all the horses were getting hot. I was sweating a lot that night, I remember, it was really hot. I mean, you drink water, but you have to be careful how much water you're drinking during racing, because you can put the weight on. I find when I'm done racing, I drink a lot of water, like so much that it's almost like you're full of water. But then it doesn't matter. But yeah, you have to watch during the racing how much you're drinking. But I only rode the one race, so it wasn't that challenging, but it was hot, I remember that day. And it is different to race in this kind of heat.
Now, certainly, even yourself, originally from Canada, which is such a, you know, a drastically colder climate by comparison, then moving further south into the United States, did you find yourself having to make adjustments from Canada, the weather, say, down around California, areas like that?
In Canada, it's so cold that you don't really feel like drinking water, and you want something warm, like soup or something, but that doesn't really work either, because it's got a lot of sodium in it. So, you know, tea, and you just gotta make yourself drink water. I guess water is this, like, big thing, and it's really important. And also, I think, you know, like you said, having muscle is really important, and it does burn more calories. I think the racing and a bit of exercise and lots of water and, like, you know, pretty balanced diet, you're going to be pretty well off. As far as the California and Canada, huge weather difference. Mm. And California, because it's so hot, and especially at Santa Anita this time of the year, you just got to make sure you're hydrated, and also just if you can stay in the shade as much as you can with your horse, that's great too. Just, I guess, trying to keep cool.
Exactly. Now, Chantelle and Xavier, both of you have traveled extensively around the world, and even for so many of our apprentice riders here this week, you know, many of them come from different points of the globe. If at all possible, now we know, you know, going to ride for other connections in the future for many of our jockeys here today, what sort of time frame would you recommend to adjust to an area like this, coming from a cooler climate? We appreciate too that riding for particular owners or stables in the future for apprentice riders, you know, budgets might be something to be considered as to how soon they get you into the country ahead of your event with accommodation and like. But in a perfect world, what sort of time frames would you be looking at for your bodies to make the adjustment to a country like this?
First thing I would like to say, like, to everyone who travel here, like Chantal came from America, there is a timing difference. So before anything, like trying to lose weight or anything, I think they must try to adapt themselves to sleep good.
Mm.
That's, I think, the base. If your body have a good rest, then you can start your day by exercising and stuff like that. I don't know what
you
want
to
say.
Yeah, no, like, I usually, the last time I came to Dubai for Game On Dude's race, I didn't feel so jet lagged, but I'm struggling today, right now. And I think the first night we got here, I didn't sleep at all that night, and then I'm just playing catch up right now. So
yeah.
I've had a little struggle with it, but probably by tomorrow. So we got here Monday, today's Thursday. Tomorrow, yeah, 3-4 days.
George, could you make any exercise recommendations with people with jet lag? It is an issue.
Well, first of all, I'm pleased that Chantel's phoned us because of jet lag, because I thought it was me. Thanks, Chantel. It wouldn't be the first time. Not with Chantel, would it? But we won't even go there anyway. So,
George.
You've got to lighten it up a bit. Come on, Victoria. What I would say is we've done a lot of studies on circadian rhythms and the way your body clock changes and acclimatization and periodization. So what you could do is obviously, like we have at the university, we actually have special chambers which changes the night and day. We actually live there. I mean, it's very expensive, but if you really wanted to go all singing, all dancing, and we have a heat chamber and we have an altitude chamber, so we can get you ready for most things. Funny enough, I've got a boxer who's fighting at Mexico City, which is 2,600 meters, and we've been trying to get him acclimatized in the altitude chamber. Now, we won't be able to do that, but we will be able to give him some indicators of what it's going to be like. I mean, you have to live in there for like 3 weeks to get it right. But yeah, I mean, there is science out there to help you. What was really interesting about the food thing is that even if we get the diet right, there's now other considerations with the actual quality of food.
Exactly, food preparation.
And this is where it's your bowel comes in, I suppose, because of mycotoxins and things like that. So, I mean, for instance, I've just come back from Belfast in Northern Ireland, and I met up at Randox, who are the new sponsors of Grand National, called Randox Healthcare. Fascinating. Please go look at Randox Healthcare. Oh, it's not just this is an advert for them. I promise you, it's fascinating. What they showed was that when you're giving people milk and things and you're eating all these foods that you think are healthy, because the animals and things have had so many antibiotics,
definitely,
they've got through and slipped through the chain, and maybe your mouth could expand a bit more on it. So what you're finding is, there's all the food that we think is healthy. I'm saying, have your high protein, have your low carbohydrates, have your healthy fats. You might be eating fish that's got heavy metals in it, or all these mycotoxins. So the game gets a bit more complex.
Yep.
So it is an all singing, all dancing approach to trying to get well-being and health. Unfortunately, because obviously people will cut corners to make money. And this is where this whole sort of old ethical thing about food comes into place. But generally, if you have good food, good nutrition, eat small and often, and do some exercise, and keep hydrated, you generally should be in pretty good condition.
Can I have a word? Sorry to cut. Because I totally agree with what you say, Doctor. And you're here to help us and to teach us how to eat, how to feed ourselves, how to get energy, you as well. But the fact is, I would like to talk as a jockey, and I think we all face the same problem. Chantal faced the problem, Richie faced the problem. Maybe Julie not, because she's quite very light. But you are trying to tell us we have to exercise, we have to eat this, we have to eat that, which is good, which will be the best for us. You recommend, and that's good, because in my time when I start was no one like you to tell me do this or do that. But our life is starting 4 o'clock in the morning, going to work, then going to work in the morning, going back to home, take a shower, going racing, driving sometimes 2, 3, 4 hours, riding the races. And you know, like, you don't ride only one race, you can ride like 5, 6, 7 races. And if, for example, I have to ride a race at 52, it won't be always the first race, it can be the last race. So I will struggle all day for the last race. So as Chantal says, we have to be careful on what we drink in the jockey rooms or whatever. And then in the night, we have to drive back home. Then it starts again the next day. So you are trying to give us the best way to follow up. But
practically.
Yeah, practically. But for us, it's quite difficult.
Xavier, I will. I'm glad, really glad you brought that up, because Phil Pritchard, who's up the top, Dr. Phil, he's up the top of the... Hello, Phil. You're not going to jump, are you, Phil? It's not that bad, is it?
Don't jump.
So everybody said, jump!
No,
anyway, what Phil has advocated for many years was exactly that problem. Yet we're saying do all these things. But how do you, practically, do you do that?
Yeah.
Now, Phil's been saying for many years, there should be a warm-up area, an exercise bike, go to treadmill at the course. I know jockeys run around, and the food at the race courses should accommodate and integrate the diet and recommendations, rather than having, I hope nobody wakes a Red Bull, but Red Bull or Lucozade, because a jockey doesn't demand that much energy that quick. They might want the electrolytes because they're dehydrated, yet we still endorse dehydration because there's a sauna in most race courses in the UK. So I understand, and I understand, I mean, Richie and me have chatted about this, but if you try to bully people and hit them with a stick to change, you'll get nowhere. But if you educate somebody and say, look, this is what happens if you go in a sauna. These are the electrolytes you lose. And then if you go and have a lot of Red Bull and Lucozade, it's just going to, you know, you're going to convert it into fat because you're not going to burn that much. Why don't you do it this way? That's a better way. And we are seeing the grassroots of change on that. But I totally take the point because, I mean, I wrote many, many years ago, as you saw in the picture, it was in black and white, you know what I mean? What I would say is that it's about education. We keep saying this, but when I take the workshops, you're completely right, Xavier. It's about the practicality. How do I do that? And what the race courses need to do is accommodate that.
Exactly.
Change the food and help the jockeys make weight.
Yeah. And this will improve our sport and will help the jockeys to do better. And another thing is, our life, most of the jockeys, we have to ride under our like lowest weight because we can't miss any rides. You know, we talk about it in Rome.
Yeah.
But because the competition in Europe or in America, it's that big, there is so many good jockeys. So if tomorrow they call you and they tell you you have to ride at 52 and you know your minimum weight is 54 or 53, you will have to push yourself to ride this horse because you can't miss it. If it's good chance, you can't miss it. You know that very well.
Agreed. And one of the things that Santa Anita has done, which is amazing, is that most of our weights are 120 and they've all kind of stayed there. So you kind of know every day you come in, you might get 122 or 120s. Basically the lowest weight, so you maintain your body for that, and it's been way easier to do that. I found when I went to race in Sweden, oh my God, I was riding with a saddle that was like as big as my hand, and then the next race was 35 pound saddle. And the fluctuation was so crazy that, you know, I was like, why does it fluctuate so much? But I guess you have different levels of horses running against. But I wonder why they're so different, is you don't have as many horses?
I don't know. I think it's the system like that, you know.
But I think it's really important that for the health of the jockey, that the weight, you kind of know generally like where you need to be. The fluctuation so much is very stressful.
Yes. Chantel, thank you. Now, recently you've made a return to race riding. Have you had any weight issues that you've had to face coming back onto the scene?
Me?
Yes.
Oh, I've always maintained my, well, in California, it's bikini season all the time, so I'm always a little careful.
That's great inspiration, I believe.
I'm going to move to California.
Now, George brought up a very important point before. The quality of our food, the additives that we're finding in the modern diet, people are getting bigger, and it's not necessarily all our own fault. We don't necessarily know what's in the food that we're eating. Dr. Jamal, your work about food intolerances and some of the nasty hidden surprises that manufacturers are putting into food or those claiming to make all these sort of healthy dietary options, they're not necessarily so, are they?
They use a lot of sugars, which is bad. All processed food has different sugars that they are bad for us now. We know that accurately. And they have a lot of additives to make the taste better. And this makes our health much worse. So just as a general recommendation, avoid all processed food. That's what we recommend. Go to the natural things. It's much better and simple things.
Certainly. Now, Dr. Mal, you've got a presentation to take us through. Are you going to...
No, we talked. Just I want to show when we finish the last, a picture of one of my patients that he lost 93 kilos over the past year.
93 kilos. How many jockeys is that? Goodness me. How many Julie Crones is that?
It will be two jockeys.
Well, given some of the new applications and therapies that we've touched on up here this afternoon, and indeed, of course, Mahi and Akina, what you present today, and Xavier, you've engaged these services and found great benefit. Mm-hmm. Certainly to some of us here in the room, Pat, many years ago, riding, would you engage some of these holistic services if you were back race riding today? Would you perhaps if you found yourself where you felt extremely tired, would you look at some of the intravenous services that Mahi and Akina are presenting to us today?
Yes, I think I would.
You would?
Look, my dad's in one.
Darius is bringing your microphone.
Sorry. Is it working, Tom? It's been idle for a while. Yes, if it was practical to do it, of course. You see, as Xavier said, we're up in the morning at God knows what time. You go and you ride schooling, you ride work or whatever, training. You dash home, you maybe have a cup of tea and two biscuits, George, perhaps.
Not three.
All right then. And then you're sitting in the car. Now, there's many a long winter's day in UK when I was riding. I would put a sweatsuit on and drive 3 or 4 hours, you know that, to get maybe, what, 1.5 kilos off. So when I got to the racetrack, I was that bit lighter, but it was maybe only my third or fourth ride where I had to do the light weight. Yeah. And the consequence, if I had 2 rides or 3 rides before, I lost a bit more. And without this water we keep talking about, one dared, I was the spitter outer, you know, you had to. Didn't flip, but you had to, you couldn't take it in because however the weight of the water you took in, you put that much weight on again, you know. And the consequence, all the sweating, and we did take Lasix tablets as well, as I said earlier this morning. Not very much in comparison with a lot of the guys in my day, they were practically living on Silurics, you know. And I mean, you could see, you knew, because you got total cramp. The trainer would leg you up and said, have a good ride, and you couldn't get your right leg straight, you know. I mean, nobody knows really, unless you've done it, what the difficulties and the uncomforts are of this game. I mean, I was unlucky in a way that I was always a bit heavier than I wanted to be on the day. A long time ago, 1964, I had to do 9 stone 7. I went into German Street Turkish Baths, which were very famous baths in London, and I stayed from Thursday evening until Saturday morning, and I lost 12 pounds.
Goodness me.
In the Turkish bath,
12 pounds.
I stayed in, you could sleep the night there. But the great thing was, I came out and I won the big race, the Whitbread World Cup, on the Saturday afternoon.
Well done. Yeah. Some of our very regimented jockey schools around the world, and indeed Melissa Weatherly from Australia. Melissa, could you just stand up for a moment? Melissa was on the panel earlier. Of course, Racing Victoria in my home state engage apprentices in a 4-year program, as Melissa alluded to earlier. Melissa, the services and the new age techniques, or perhaps new applications in health therapies that we've had discussed up here today, how would a fairly tightly run operation like Racing Victoria, who take great responsibility for their apprentice jockeys, how would you view some of these opportunities or health services that we've discussed up here today? Do you think that the school would look at extending to more holistic ways, or indeed perhaps some of the young people that you've got in your care, if they were to become severely affected from, say, if we had a hot weather situation where we had sort of over 40 degree temperatures for a number of days on end?
Well, we were lucky that we've got a great team that we have access to, our sports psychologist, physiotherapist, nutritionist, chief medical officer are all experts in their field, not just at a national level, but an international level as well. So anything that we do within our program, we would always consult with those people. Probably it's important for the young people to be mindful of the fact it's about, as they said, it's about education, and you need to know what you're putting into your body. We had a jockey who was suspended for a couple of months or a month because he got it was a supplement drink, and they looked into it and thought it was all good and it had come from America, but it actually contained a prohibitive substance. So we always say to our apprentices, like, anything, they need to consult with our chief medical officer for a start, because sometimes you don't know what you're putting into your body. So as was discussed, whole foods, and like George said, you think you're doing the right thing by what you're eating, but you have to even think about those things, the type of milk or what you're actually putting into your body. So we would always consult with our team that we work with anything that we're doing. And it's easy to tell a 15-year-old, you should do this and you should eat that, but until it's relevant to you. And Chantal and Xavier's talking, they're talking from years and years of experience and knowing their bodies. And Chantal realised that yoga was something that worked for her. Like Geordie just said, he does a lot of running. We have other jockeys that would do boxing. So they're finding as they develop what works for them. So it's important, their education, to learn what works for you and to consult with other people.
Melissa, thank you. Well, I hope that we've opened your minds here today perhaps to, or taken a new light on weight loss, which is really much a fairly age-old problem, unfortunately, for our riders. Now, Dr. Jamal, you've got some slides here you wanted to run through before we close.
Just wanted to add something in regards with the supplements, as she correctly said.
Maha, your microphone.
Sorry. It's very, very important. We can all hear during the last year, maybe, all over the world, that there are lots of athletes that they've been restricted because they were taking supplements, because they were not eating the right food, or because for some reason something got elevated in their blood test and they couldn't perform as they would they wish. You should always, always make sure. The pharmaceutical industry is growing very fast. You might think you're taking supplements, you might think you're taking the right supplements, but you should always cross-check, double-check with your agents, by yourself. You can look, there's a lot of literature online, but you should always make sure that what you're taking is pure supplements and nothing more. I always recommend to our clients, to everyone, even my friends, even my family, that if you want to take vitamin C or B12 or zinc for your immune system and energy levels, take pure vitamin C and B12. Always double check all the multivitamins, always double check. There's lots of them that they've been out of the market. Unfortunately, there are some of them that they're still being sold. But you need to make sure, because you don't want all that hard work during the last year or during the last few months to end because you just took the wrong things. And make sure quality.
Yeah, that's right. Sorry.
I think further testimony to what Mahi's just said there, anyone who's got access on their mobile phone, if you Google the Essendon football team in Australia, you'll see the wrong outcome of what Mahi's just raised. Now, Dr. Jamal, take us through here. We have a rather large type. Yes. Goodness me. What happened there?
He lost 93 kilos.
In what time frame?
13 months.
13 months.
Yeah.
And how old is the gentleman when he started his weight loss?
He's happy.
He's happy, but how...
And healthy.
How old was he when he realised that he wanted to get rid of this weight?
Unfortunately, it was so late now.
Yeah.
But he didn't know me before.
Ah, okay. Well, that's an extraordinary reduction, and goodness me, we hope no one binge eats to that extent. That's almost frightening. Yeah. Gosh. Goodness me. Do we have any further questions from our audience here this afternoon?
Sorry, before we start the question, I just would like to say thanks to His Highness Sheikh Mansour and the support of Lara to bring us here to discuss with the doctors, because nowhere else jockeys will have chance to learn all of these things. I test myself the vitamin drips, and to be honest, Lara pushed me to do it. And I was, first of all, I don't like injection. So she talks to me 4 or 5 times about it. And Richie will confirm this. I didn't want it. I did it. And I really recommend to all the jockeys to try it. Because the week before I had this injection, I was going to work. I wake up in the morning. I was going to work a bit tired. 2 days after the injection, the day after I was the same, but the second day, I wake up better, you know, happy and feel like more power. So it is pretty new in our business. Maybe in other sports, it's over there for a long time, I don't know. But in our business as a jockey, no one knows about it. And it's really helpful for us. So thanks, Lara, to push me hard for that.
And thank you, Lara.
And thanks to the doctors for the work you are doing. Thank you very much.
Xavier, thank you. Now, Dirk, you have a question here. Richard?
Sorry, George, I just want to pick your brains now. Obviously, you've dealt with a lot of jockeys in the UK, and obviously the lifestyle of a UK jockey is completely different. Have you seen a change in the racecourses mentality, though? Because when I was there, the food that's served in jockeys' rooms isn't fit for dogs. It's absolutely a joke. It's ridiculous. I'm just wondering, it's all right you educating these jockeys, but then if they're trying to do this, and then they're going to the races, and you've got fried food, you know, Coke, fizzy drinks, that's all that's on offer. And they have to eat something, they're going to go back to that.
Yeah, and
now, surely the race courses need to be brought on board and be educated at the same time.
Yeah, it's a financial thing really, Richard. We come across this and race courses said, well, it's financial, and at the end of the day, when there's only a small amount of money, I suppose they think they get the most what they can win. But what we did do, is just to answer your question quickly, is that the jockeys we work with, we say, look, prepare your food yourselves, take your own. So a lot of them now are actually preparing their own, and they're not going near the race course rubbish that you mentioned, which is right, you know what I mean? So to answer your question, a lot of them are getting more prepared themselves. So it is changing. Yeah, definitely.
Richie, I might be able to answer that. As you know, I work on the race course, and I do 100 days a year on the race course, and I see this. The sad thing is that one or two race courses did remove the Cokes and the Red Bulls and all the fast fixes, and the Derek knows exactly what I'm going to say. The jockeys all started jumping up and down. So you can't blame the race courses per se. It has got to come from the education.
But Phil, you can't endorse it.
No, absolutely, George, but it's down to us to educate the jockeys in the first place. And as you rightly say, there is no reason why the jockeys can't prepare their own
absolutely.
Stuff. You know, absolutely. And just on the matter, Lara, I'd like to thank you ever so much. As you know, 4 years ago, I suggested that we should look into this, and it's thanks to yourself and His Highness Sheikh Mansour that we've made such progress. Thank you ever so much.
Cheers.
Just got one more question. The gentleman right in the middle at the back, he's been waiting to ask a question. Sir, who are you? Where are you from?
Sorry, it's Matt Camacho again from the Racing Post. I appreciate we're short of time, so I'll try and keep this brief. But I just wanted to touch on something that Chantal just mentioned, which is a small change by racing administration that had a big effect on the jockeys. Because we're hearing from Dr. Wilson the pressure that jockeys are under on a daily basis. We're hearing from Xavier and Chantal the daily struggles. We're hearing from Pat what he has to do to win a Hennessy Gold Cup. I sometimes get put under pressure in my job, but my boss lets me swallow water, which is really, really, you know, a blessing for us. It's interesting to hear the pressure that people are put under. But the change by racing administration had a profound effect on how Chantal can run her life. I think in my lifetime in racing, the minimum weight has gone up probably over half a stone. And I wondered what process racing administrators go through when they look at the weight scales. Because obviously they're aware of the pressure that jockeys are under to meet a number. We've got some racing administrators in the room, and that's, you know, I don't understand the area well enough. I wondered how frequently the weight scales are addressed.
It's an interesting one,
there. Yeah. Can I answer that? Just because what happened with our jockeys, our Jocks Guild representative, Gerald Hare, went around to all the jockeys in the jocks room and got them to honestly tell the actual weight that you are wanting to ride at and what you can actually do comfortably. And there's a lot of jockeys who lie on that weight in the program because they want so badly for the trainer to ride them. But when you get your jockeys to come together, and we came together as a group and said, okay, let's be real now. This is what we can all really do. And there are other lighter jockeys, like Rafael Bejarano walks in at 108 pounds, and you're like, oh, I wish I could be like that, but for the rest of us, that's not what we are. And he was willing to you know, ride with a bigger saddle, and you know, it's the median. So we came somewhere in the middle. So that's how they got to the weights that we're at now, and I mean, we're all a lot healthier, happier. It was just that 3 pounds.
Can I just pick up on the point as well? Following on from that, what we've suggested at John Moores University is that we establish the healthy minimum weight for each jockey that comes in. So if an apprentice walks in who's 5'7", you know, and then we've got one who's 5 foot, If we are going to establish by testing them when they're hydrated, so not just urine, we'll look at the blood, and we're going to say, right, you're in a hydrated state, you haven't come in here dehydrated, so it's not going to be a false minimum weight. And we'll DEXA scan them, we'll scan their body, we'll look at their minimum amount of body fat that they can have to be healthy and safe and maintain normal immune function. And then we will establish their safest minimum rate. And then the authorities have that. So when they go in the weighing room, and if they are obviously trying to achieve weights under that, they have to be physiologically dehydrated, unless they've lost an arm. You know, what I'm saying is, on a serious point, is that we can actually do something. And I think in France, they actually do establish minimum weights, but I think worldwide this should be taken on. So I think that's a really, really good point, yeah.
That is very good. I know you have to have a minimum weight to be able to get a license here in the UAE.
Yeah, before you get your license here, you have to declare your minimum riding weight.
Yeah.
If you can't do that weight, then you don't ride.
Yeah. What was saying about the hydration part?
I noticed when you did your demonstration that you had the picture of the food and then you quickly slipped on the side. You went, and then you said, oh, yeah, occasionally you need those bad foods. Is that like a psychological fun thing?
Absolutely, because Julie, we're all human, aren't we? And we need to, you know, let our, you know, for those of you who've got hair, we need to let it down, you know what I mean? But what I would say is that you do need that psychological sort of, you know, time to just get away from this absolute, because jockeys are the only athletes in the world who have to make weight possibly 365 days a week. How many times do you used to jump on the scales? I mean, when I rode, I was on the scales. Tom, you rode?
10 times a day.
10, 15, 20
exactly.
times a day.
It's crazy, isn't it? You know.
I had to stay 102 every day.
Yeah,
yeah. And then after my severe injuries, I had ulcerative colitis so bad that my friends came to pick me up to go to a racetrack. We all went together so we could share the driving. And they couldn't get in the house, and I was passed out. I had bled, and I was almost like dying because after I broke my ankle, I had so many medicines, and my gut was so unhealthy that I was so, like, I didn't know, but it was almost like I was fasting, and I didn't even know that my intestine wasn't absorbing any food or anything. And I learned so much of what you guys have just said was something, I almost died because of what you heal people every day that you probably see like that all the time. But I thought that was a cool comment.
Yeah, but it's important to let your hair down now and again. Yeah, definitely.
Lovely.
Absolutely.
And some of us understood the Scouse accent, which is even more incredible.
Tomo, the Beatles are from Liverpool.
Exactly, I tell you.
Best band in the world. What more do you want?
I don't know about you, but after that.
And a Grand National.
I'm starving after all this. Thank you very much indeed. Absolutely. Victoria, wonderful. Brilliant. Superb. Dinner will be served at 8 o'clock tonight. It is salsa night tonight. Oh, we're live. And tomorrow we're back here at 10:30.
Yeah.
Stay with us.
Thanks. Well done.